moving out, and you are going to you're assigned to the 10th Engineer Combat Team.
Right.
And you were a radio operator.
Right.
And part of the reason was that you also had a background in Morse code.
Right.
Where did you learn Morse code?
When I was a kid, I was a Boy Scout. And my next door neighbor was my age too. We strung wire up from his house to my house. Not a big distance, maybe 20 feet, something like that. And we had the bell coils, and we used to send each other messages. So I knew the Morse code, and when this colonel came looking for somebody for help, he picked me out, and you know, I had a jump on most of them, and.
Well, I mean, Morse code, I had a little bit of background on that.
Yeah.
It's not the easiest thing to pick up, you know,
yeah.
Especially when it's coming at you fast and you're trying to send things fast.
Well, fortunately, most of the messages that I didn't have to, speed didn't count, but accuracy. You know, if you got a message to go to such and such a place at 6 o'clock, you could take your time sending the message and get it right.
But anyway, that's the reason you are now a radio operator, and you will then embark on an LCI, which is Landing Craft Infantry.
Right.
So you get on the LCI, and what was going to happen is they're going to do an end run, and around to get to Rome,
right.
And so you are at Anzio, one of the
major battles
of
the United States Army, right?
But when you land, you were actually the first one off the.
Well, one of the first. We were in the first wave, yeah.
Yeah.
But you're right. There was very little activity. Mm-hmm. Some shelling. We it seemed as though we could advance at will.
Yep.
But went so far a little bit, and all at once the word comes, stand where you are.
Well, that has been historically second-guessed. General Clark was the commander.
Yeah.
And he has been chastised for not advancing right away because it gave the Germans.
Supposedly they say we could have taken Rome that very first night.
Yeah.
But like you say, it's second-guessed. Some say yes, some say no.
But the Germans did come down, and now they fortified their area.
Yeah, they did.
And they established artillery and mortars. And
they did a good job at it too.
So you were in constant, I say constant, in a 24-hour period, there was always shelling.
Yeah.
Of one kind or another.
Yeah.
They had the famous German 88mm artillery piece.
Yeah, Anzio Annie. Yeah.
Anzio Annie, the big railroad gun.
Right. Yeah.
And so you could hear the shells going off and the.
It was there that, for the first time, that I heard what we used to call them screaming memes. They had
rockets.
Yeah, rockets on a jeep, and they'd all go out together. It was very awesome, you know, to see it. And
you mean going out or coming in?
Out.
Going out.
No, wait a minute. Coming in.
Coming in from the Germans.
Yeah, yeah.
So you heard the screaming memes, and one never knows where they're going to land. And,
yeah.
Well, but you talked about you had time to dig a.
A dugout. Yeah,
why
we
you
did.
Tell us about the
guy
that,
and
how that worked.
Well, we piled the dirt up, the mud really, and then we just made it like a little hole. But then when the thing got baked, we could crawl in and crawl out. Mm-hmm. The Italian sunshine baked it just as hard as that, just as like cement.
Mm-hmm. So that gave you some protection from
it did.
Artillery.
Yeah. Yeah. The Germans had an anti-personnel shell that it was devised for personnel, not for shell buildings and places like that. And our dugout was hit a few times with the personnel shell, but it didn't hurt.
Didn't penetrate. Yeah.
Right. Didn't penetrate.
Well, there were people. I mean, statistically, there were the Anzio. There were lots of fatalities and lots of. Injuries and wounds, and so that you escaped that whole thing. That your ability to.
I didn't get hit, no.
Didn't get hit there at all.
No, I didn't get hit.
Then there was a kind of a breakout.
Yeah.
And you actually came into Rome.
Right.
Were the first people into Rome.
One of the first.
One of the first.
See, you always have to say one of, because if when you're going to take a place, maybe the third division goes in, the fourth division might go in, and the fifth division might go in. Yep. So if you say we were the first, well, you got it sort of.
Yeah, well, it was a massive.
All of us. Yeah.
You were in the third division, by the way, which was the division made one of the divisions made famous by Audie Murphy. Who was in your division?
I saw Audie Murphy when he was awarded his
Medal of Honor.
Yeah.
Really?
I was in the parade. That
kidding.
Passing. Well, you don't do anything. You just, you know.
Well, he was in your division.
He was, yeah. Or I was in his.
But
what do you remember?
What do you remember about actually the liberation of Rome, and what did you see?
Yeah, very, very excited. Very excited. A lot of excitement. People coming out of houses with wine and Italian candies that they make. Girls kissing you and hugging you. And it was really an
They were just happy that the war was over for them and they were being.
Yeah, fortunately, see, Rome was not bombed. It was called an open city, so they had it tough in the fact that they were short of food and things like that. But as far as being physically hurt, they were not physically hurt.
But while you were in Rome, you also you were pulled off the line, and you because you had so much combat in Anzio, there was a certain. So you went back to an area. By Naples called
Pozzoli.
Pozzoli. And it is famous in your eyes for two reasons. And what are they?
Well, that's the spot that St. Paul stopped at when he came to Rome, from the Holy Land to Rome. And in fact, there's a footprint there, and they say this is where he stepped, which may or may not be true. But for grown-ups, it's also the town that for Sophia Loren lived in.
She would have been about 8 years old at the time.
That's
you
correct.
Calculated
and what I would do after every meal, I would go to the. We had a hole where you'd throw all your scraps. I would go there and I would take all the food scraps in my mess kit. After every meal, no matter what we had, I would go back and get the scraps, and go to the garbage hole. That's what. But I'd give it to the kids, and. I tell my wife it's impossible that one of those meals, we were there a month, I was given three meals a day, so it's over 100 meals. It's impossible to think one of those meals I didn't give food to Sophia Loren.
Well, I remember in her biography, she talked about that.
Yeah, she did.
And that's how her family survived. Americans in her hometown.
Right.
Yeah. And there's one other thing I mentioned that I forgot to mention. When you were in Rome, you actually went to St. Peter's.
I did, yeah.
Well,
we went to the church. Anybody can just walk into the church. But while we were there, somebody came and said, you want to see the Pope? You want to see the Pope? We thought it was a joke, but we followed him, and we saw the Pope in a room about as big as this, very close. Mm-hmm. And we were the only people to see the Pope while we were wearing firearms, mm-hmm. or we were carrying firearms.
Well, times are very much different.
Yeah, right.
But anyway, you then embark again when your R&R is over, and you're on a LCI again
Landship
Infantry.
Yeah.
And you land at the southern France
We landed at Saint-Tropez.
Saint-Tropez, which is famous.
Now it's a very famous
resort
rich
area.
People.
There wasn't a resort area.
No,
at the
we
time.
Didn't have it.
And then you started the race to Germany.
Well, we first went straight up the Rhone Valley, all the way up until we came to Salzburg, I believe, yeah.
And so this was after the Battle of the Bulge. The Battle of the Bulge had been going on, but that was a different part.
Yeah, the Battle of the Bulge hadn't started yet.
Yeah. Okay.
No, right.
But you were going on one side.
They were in the other.
But so you got at some point, you got actually to the Rhine River.
When we reached Salzburg, we reached Strasbourg, the Rhine River, that's where we crossed.
Now, the Rhine River divides France
and Germany.
So that was the last bastion, the last of defense point for the German military.
Yeah, Germans were out there.
So, but you, how did you cross the Rhine River?
We were, did it in a pontoon boat.
Pontoon?
Yeah.
Yeah, and you actually paddled across?
Yeah.
Were you under fire at all, or do you remember?
If there was, it was scattered.
Yeah.
You know, you, if you don't remember it, you know, it wasn't in, yeah. It wasn't.
So what you had in your, so far, is you had moments of boredom, long moments of boredom, but you had moments of fright and terror almost.
Oh, that's surely right.
Yeah. I think that when I talk to do this oral history, it's very much the same. Hours of boredom, moments of terror.
Yeah.
Yeah. But anyway, so you cross into Germany. Now, by the time you crossed into Germany, the timing, the months, the Germans started to surrender. Is that correct?
Well, it was, they were given up. I'd say yes. They're not, there was any mass surrender ever, but.
In fact, didn't you capture two Germans?
Well, I did, yeah, I did.
Well, let's hear the story.
Well, what happened was I was on guard duty with the 50 caliber machine gun, and all at once two guys jump out of some bushes, put their hands up, "Camarade, camarade," and I swung the gun around. The poor guy probably thought I was gonna shoot him. I was more nervous than he was, and he probably thought, "Jesus, this little pipsqueak is gonna kill us." But somebody else came, our sergeant came, and he took him in. Mm-hmm. But in war, I don't know what the percentage is of the people who actually have seen the enemy. It's like only like 1% actually sees the enemy. Mm-hmm. And by me seeing those two Germans, you know,
put a face on what this is all about.
Yeah, it made me feel pretty good that actually you're in a category of that very, very few people are actually in.
Well, that's understated.